for being here. I know that a lot of our residents are out of town, but we're awfully glad that you stayed and are here to have a visit from a woman who became known to us, I guess, within the last year for her wonderful memoir about her her growing up. And it's something that's in our library collection, and I urge you all to read it if you haven't. Her name is Carol Gaunt. Carol received the inaugural Anne Bancroft Memorial Memoir Writing Award for her memoir, Hungry Hill, which was presented to her by the late Frank McCourt at the Stony Brook Southampton Writers Conference. In reviewing the memoir, Frank McCourt wrote, "Hungry Hill is more than a memoir. It is a social document, a story of a family, a document on the human heart." And he's referring to Carol. Carol writes with such compassion and understanding, you'll look at your own family the same way. Other reviewers had the following insights. "Hungry Hill is the sort of tale that makes us shiver and count our blessings. The harsh reality of her experience is so unsettling that our instinct is to look the other way." And that was reported by the Irish Voice. The Boston Globe said, "What readers will take away from it, besides Carol Gaunt's skillful wielding of language and narrative structure, is a sense of this Irish Catholic teenager as a survivor who pushes back against the terrible tide of loss to seek her footing in the wider world." Roger Rosenblatt had said that, had this to say, "Without a false note, a word wasted, or a flinch, one is grateful for this memoir and for the author who, as a child, kept her eyes open." And finally, Kirkus Reviews said the following, "Not only does the author write movingly of her dysfunctional family life, she provides an achingly honest picture of a teenager hungrily seeking at school the approval she does not receive at home." Carol Gaunt has been a keynote speaker at several colleges and participated in panels at NYU, at Marymount Manhattan, at SUNY Stony Brook Southampton, and at the University of Massachusetts. Her memoir has been required reading for both high school and college students. Her award-winning play, Dance of the Seven-Headed Mouse, was produced off-Broadway at Theater Row. She was a producer of the musical Cat and the Kings, which ran for 180 performances at Broadway's Court Theater. Carol Gaunt lives in New York, in North Haven, and I understand also, maybe fairly recently, in Florida, part-time. It's a pleasure to have us, to have Carol with us today. Please welcome Carol Gaunt.
Thank you, Penny. You've been reading the reviews.
I've been reading the reviews.
Yeah.
I read the book, too.
Oh, that's good. That's above and beyond. Right. It is mid-February 2008. A late, rainy afternoon. A retired Springfield cop, exuberant, gushing, is on the phone, pleased to have reached me in New York, surprised that my husband and I are listed. He identifies himself as a friend of three of my brothers. I have seven. Went to their weddings and has just finished reading my memoir, Hungry Hill. He talks fast. His words spill over one another as he recalls coming-of-age stories featuring my brothers and him as the central characters. After he slows and takes a breath, he apologizes to me for bad behavior of his dating back to an O'Malley family Christmas party some 35 years ago. With the kindness of time, neither he nor I remember whatever he had said or done at that holiday family feast all those years ago. We chuckle. Then his voice drops, his words inch out, and he trusts me with his secret. As a child, before going to bed every night, he would get down on his knees and silently pray that his angry, raging father would die. A hard truth. Stunned, I picture that boy in his flannel cowboy pajamas, his crew cut, his bitten nails, with a child's guilt and a child's confusion hidden in his prayers. As if honesty were a tipping point, Hungry Hill has given many readers the freedom to open up and share their childhood secrets. The Policeman's Confession is not unique. I have heard readers' secrets, all sad, startling stories. The restaurant owner, who as a child plucked poisonous red berries from the backyard, smashed them into eggs, served them to her father, watched him take a bite, fully expecting him to foam at the mouth and keel over. When he threw the plate against the kitchen wall, she knew her intended patricide had failed. In the movie Gone Baby Gone, one of my favorites, set in an Irish enclave of Dorchester, Massachusetts, the bad cop, a transplanted southerner, Ed Harris, menaces an accomplice who is leaning towards revealing the dark truth of a child's kidnapping with a threat. Where I come from, boy, you die with your secrets. Certainly in Western Massachusetts, the setting for my memoir, some regard Hungry Hill as an outright act of family betrayal, a secret that should have stayed a secret. In writing my memoir, Hungry Hill, I wanted to show how the premature death of a parent and a father's alcoholism affect the children in the family. Tatum O'Neill, Christopher Kennedy Lawford, and James Fry memoirs, Tales of the Addict's Recovery, line the bookshelves. But these books ignore the victims at the party who are left in the wake of the person who is using and or drinking. A mother's death and a father's drinking led my brothers and me to abnormal behavior, abnormal responses, an assumption of family roles, and a medley of defense mechanisms to keep the pain of their deaths and the loss at bay. For the most part, this is my story, the story of the second oldest of eight children and the only girl. When I was 13, my mother died of lymphatic cancer, a raging cancer, quick and deadly. In 1959, the year she died, no one said the word cancer aloud. It was always whispered. In writing a memoir, Frank McCourt advises to write the hot spots. After my mother died at age 40, nothing would ever be the same in the O'Malley family. Her death was the hot spot. I was ashamed that my mother had died, and ashamed of my shame. But overnight, her death had made me different. I was no longer like anyone else, like any of my friends. And the last thing I wanted to be as a teenager, or maybe at any age, is to be different. But there it was. I was a maternal orphan, an expression from the book Orphans by Eileen Simpson. Keeping quiet let me hide her death. I became quite the expert at keeping quiet. The roles in the O'Malley family among us children were many and varied. The hero, the scapegoat, the lost child, the mascot, the taker, the Eeyore. At times, we would flow in and out of these roles, dropping one, taking on another. Everything was fast and fluid. Hungry Hill is not a clinician's book. I intentionally wanted readers to draw her or his own conclusions and to analyze the children's behaviors as they watch the family saga play out. With the roles in an alcoholic family, or any family where addiction or dysfunction is an issue, the children take on many roles and weave in and out of these roles. When a parent dies, the bereaved wife may end up sharing her confidences with the oldest son, and the widowed father may share his sadness with the oldest daughter. Although there is nothing physical, there is a blurring of emotional boundaries, making the child the surrogate spouse. My father might take me to the movies, that kind of thing. The scapegoat manages to get all the anger in the family. In my particular family, one of my brothers was the angriest. We were all afraid of him, and pretty much are to this day. That meant that none of the other children in the family could get angry. That would risk his anger. The scapegoat is the least attractive publicly, brings a certain amount of notoriety to the family. The person who picks up the substance as a preteen, the person who gets into fights and brings the police into the home. The scapegoat in the family is getting out of his anger and the sick feelings of the family, and maybe the one whose behavior is noticed by service professionals, school guidance counselors, school administrators, certainly. Then we had additional roles not covered in the alcoholic literature. The Eeyore role lives under a black cloud and cannot, nor does he ever try, to find happiness and joy. And the taker, the one who takes everything, the selfish one, the one who is always going to find the easiest way, manipulative, doesn't care for anyone else or the consequences of his behavior. These roles build resentment. You resent them for being selfish or angry, and they resent you because you can never give them enough. There is never enough emotionally to go around in a family like this. There is never enough attention. The lost child is the one for whom everyone feels sorry. At some point, all of us play the part of the lost child. For me, I can slip into this role after a time when I've been signing books or speaking. I need that time to decompress, to be by myself. I just want to sit and veg out and watch reruns of Law and Order, though they're getting harder to find. If someone calls on the phone or enters the room, I don't really want to be there for that person. In a sense, the lost child is an easy role to play because you aren't confronting life, not taking any kind of a risk. You're doing things that are safe and comfortable. When you get older, you don't do anything. You don't create a life for yourself. You need to take risks. You need to be able to expose yourself to other people's criticism and judgment. I'm not giving anything away by saying that my brother Jerry, who's the fourth one in the family, was the mascot. It's great to have a mascot or a clown in the family. They are the tricksters, the masters of the one-liners. We were all pretty glib, sarcastic, funny, but there was an edge of cruelty. We made a joke of everything. That was how we got through things. I later learned to look at the people in my life who make a joke of everything. Not a constructive way to build a friendship. By gender and perhaps competence, I stepped into the role of caretaker, surrogate spouse, family hero. No authority figure ever articulated that the pranks and the acting out that often accompany a normal adolescence were off limits to me. But when a parent dies prematurely, all kinds of juggling and assumptions ensue. In a big family, the oldest girl as caretaker is a given. Other than finding ways to be out of the house, which I did, I don't know of any way to avoid it. I liked being the caregiver and the handler of the family logistics, a mini General Patton. The hero role results in outside validation, positive feedback, but these caring deeds are ignored and taken for granted within the family. The hero brings positive good to the family. My brother Jerry said to me when I was writing the book, "Carol, do you remember how proud we were of your academic success?" Well, that's revisionist history. Well, this is news to me. You never once said that you were proud of my academic success. No one did. As the mascot in the family, he began smirking and said, "Well, it was implied." Family members of yours, all those compliments they could be giving you, but instead here they are, implied. No one in a family of this kind ever compliments one another. You were just too busy with survival. No time for the niceties, the luxury of that. A reader described Hungry Hill as a series of tragedies playing out in a veil of surreal mirth. There are no feelings in families that have substance abuse and addiction. The children just plow through any way they can, taking on defenses to get through the pain of loss, a long list of defenses, ways of adapting. One of mine, as the hero, was to keep busy. I was busy. I was always doing things because I didn't want to sit still and face what was going on in my life. But when a caring aunt told me at my mother's wake I needed to be brave for my brothers and to stop crying, I thought, okay, I do need to be brave to be strong for my brothers. But I didn't allow myself to stop and think, if I can't cry when my mother dies, when can I? So that's another defense. Be tough, be strong, be the problem solver. In my addictive family, there were no rules, no curfews. I could come in whenever I wanted, no questions asked. No one seemed concerned about my comings and goings. But a child in an addictive family could also grow up with equally harsh rules, the strictest family in town. Very black and white, very all or nothing, very little gray. Whatever roles the people in the family are playing, feelings of uneasiness and discomfort prevail. I am my family. I am the hero. I am the scapegoat. I am never myself. I am enmeshed into the shame that comes from my alcoholic father and his drinking. I was comparing myself to some ideal all the time, to the outsides of other people. Compare, despair, as they say in 12-step programs. As soon as I start comparing myself to someone else, I set myself up for a state of despair. Someone is always out there who's richer, smarter, thinner, younger. It's a no-win, but another way of avoiding who I am. I hide by being addicted to work, television, pirate booty, causes, or hide by being in or out of the house most of the time. Anything to avoid being alone with myself. As an adult, looking back, I certainly wished I had known the pathos of the situation more. I wish that I'd been able to say, certainly to a professor or a teacher, my mother is dead and I'm so frightened of things that are happening in my home. Just to be able to say that. But I had to be invulnerable. I had to be perfect. I never allowed myself to say I'm hurting. I can't do this. Death is overwhelming. Lately, I've been wondering if there is a connection between loss, death, and substance abuse. Loss is a whole. Coping with loss meant pulling out the mantle of defense mechanisms to get through the morning. I would often pretend that my mother wasn't dead, that she was getting her hair done, or that she was on her way home from shopping downtown. That lasted maybe a year and a half. These were the ways I used not to accept the fact that she wasn't there. As an adult, I say, how could it have been different? This was back in the 50s, the early 60s, and for Irish Catholics, prayer was the only barrier. And now for the secrecy part. After reading my memoir, a black Southern minister in a radio interview asked me how the memoir stands up to the challenges of secrecy and betrayal. This question made me stop and think. This is it, the paradox. The multicultural taboo isn't particularly Irish. I have railed against by finally telling the stories I buried for years. The bread and the bone secrets of my adolescent feelings about my mother's death, my father's alcoholism, and his death from the complications of alcoholism. When I came back to the minister's question, I answered that if someone suffers, is giving too much mental energy to pieces of his history, he cannot bring himself to say aloud, that he needs to take a deep breath, find a small group of understanding, non-judgmental friends, and let these secrets rip. It is freeing. But for me anyway, there was no magic wand at work here. The secrets do not disappear. They still are afloat in me, but my soul feels lighter, as if a set of clinging tentacles have been mopped off. Let me close with a comment of a reader who grew up on Hungry Hill, which is the name of the neighborhood in which I grew up. This man's wife died around the same age that my mother was, leaving him with two daughters, 12 and 16. After her death, he shared that his Irish genes kicked in, and like my father, he began drinking heavily. After a time, by God's grace, his words again, he got sober in AA. After he finished reading Hungry Hill, he ceded it to his now adult daughters. The book may represent to him and others in recovery a picture of a way their lives could have gone. Silence and secrecy create a shame all their own. Thank you. Not really a barrel of laughs today.
Would you take some questions?
Sure.
I'd like to ask one. So you were obviously an adult by the time you wrote this book.
Yes.
Can you just talk about how you came to write this book? I mean, you obviously have gone through a number of years in various stages of your life before you became an adult and into adulthood and had your own children, right? All right, so I'm interested in...
I think that if you've grown up with this kind of family background, or at least for me, I needed to reach a point in my life where I could say, I did not go down that same path. I did not take my children down that same path. I created a different path. And I'm not sure I could have written the book at an earlier time. If I had, it would have been a different book. So I think that you have to reach a point in your life where you can say, you know, I almost made it. I didn't replicate it. I didn't create that same cycle of whatever it was.
Was that, it must have been quite wonderful for your children to get to know you, or, you know, it must have been revelatory for them to see what you had to write about, to see what you liked.
When the book came out, my youngest daughter, Victoria, had just graduated from college, and the book came out in early June, so she came up with me on a couple of trips to Western Massachusetts, and we really did have a lot of fun. My middle daughter, at a certain point, I, of course, was in therapy for most of my adult life, and at one point when my oldest daughter was about 10 or 11, she said, Mom, I don't want to hear stories about your childhood anymore. And I thought she had a valid point, so I stopped telling her. My middle daughter read the book and said, I knew that your life was bleak. I just didn't know how bleak it was. And my oldest daughter was very supportive as well. My brothers, not so much.
I was going to ask. Especially Jerry.
Now, Jerry was very, well, Jerry is very funny. Several of them live in Western Massachusetts, so I did a lot of promoting of the book up in Western Massachusetts, where I am a rock star. I actually went into a store and bought a pair of earrings, and I gave the woman my credit card, and she said, oh my God, you can't hold me like that. Jerry would meet me for lunch, and his line was, that's it, Carol, I'm crossing enemy lines to meet you. So that's how, you know, several of my brothers weren't too excited about the book. But it would be interesting because friends of theirs would come to book signings and would start telling me stories. So one fellow came in and I said, so when did you have your first encounter with the police? Joking, I thought, question. There. He said, oh, you mean the stolen car? No, I never knew about the stolen car until that moment. And I said, so what's the story about the stolen car? And he said, well, you know, there were three of them. They were out, and one of them stole the car, and he and my brother were in the car, and they were very lucky that the policeman who stopped them knew the father of one of them, so they didn't get caught for that particular instance. And then there were other stories that would come out, you know, brothers, women that my brothers dated, or as they would all say, women that wanted to date my brothers, they all came out too for book signings in Massachusetts.
Carol,
well,
I've, you know, discussed the book. I haven't read it yet, which I'm really looking forward to with Marianne. And I'm assuming you did a lot of research on alcoholism as you wrote the book, or you needed to know about it, and what the gene, quote-unquote, of the Irish Catholic family or culture has, and if that's really a valid, or is it just a myth? You know, I mean, I don't think people really realize it, because they don't really talk about it on news shows or anything, about alcoholism that much, and be what it really does physically to you, and how it can be a physical thing that one inherits. Do you have anything that could sort of, you know, give proof for that you've learned to share with us?
Well, I can't cite any facts, but I was on the board of the Alcoholism Council of New York, and sad to say, there is a feeling that it is genetic, that certainly a predisposition to alcoholism is genetic. But what I say, you know, it's the old nature versus nurture kind of thing. Growing up in the kind of family in which I grew up, there were no other choices. You know, my father would have to drink on Sunday after Mass. There was no tennis, there was no golf. Drinking was it. This was it. And there was a lot of alcohol thinking, all of which I learned later, which was very black and white thinking. You pick up a tennis racket, you pick up a basketball. If you weren't a star from the get-go, then you weren't a star. The concept of process and slow plodding did not exist in my family. So I believe that it's not only genetic, but it's also what you learn growing up in your family, or what you see, what you observe. It's pretty easy to find the fact that they believe it's genetic, at least the predisposition.
In your own family, then, with your children, did you have discussions about alcohol?
Oh, yeah. I would say. I took many parenting seminars or whatever, because I had no idea how to parent. Well, most people don't, I don't think. But I probably took it to the extreme. And if there were any kind of a lecture on addiction, drinking, adolescence, whatever, I pretty much went to it. And New York City was a golden resource for this. And I remember a woman who was the director of a rehab in Westchester saying that, you know, you need to have these discussions early. You don't wait until the child is 13. You have it when you're 11. And so I think I asked her what would be a good consequence. And she said, well, you could say if they're caught drinking, smoking, or any kind of a drug, they're grounded for a month, no questions asked. And sure enough, my daughter at age 13 was caught with cigarettes, which when she was confronted with this, in our family discussion, said, this was not my gateway drug. So then we said, well, now that you've said that, what was your gateway drug? And she and a friend had gone to a Korean deli and had bought a can of beer at age 13. It was interesting because she's the oldest, and her younger sisters were witnessing this, although we had asked them to go in the other room. And you could see the look of horror on their faces that this could happen to them as well. So that's the kind of thing. So whenever I heard of something that made sense to me, sometimes I overreact. Neither are they. No, they are. They're pretty good. And then I would call them occasionally. I haven't done it in a while. I call them, I think, twice. You know, I call them on a Sunday morning and say, so, how many drinks did you have last night? Just checking it. You know, they're older now. The results were always surprising. And, of course, they lie, probably. Any other questions? Yes.
How about your brothers and their drinking? Do they have any problems with it?
Of the eight of us, seven of us are sober. So seven of us don't drink. I, the hero, was the first one to stop drinking in the family, but that didn't matter because I was the girl. I was crazy. And my youngest brother was the first male in the family to stop drinking. Now, he had lived with a woman for 7 or 8 years, and they had gone through a breakup. And he just about fell apart after that, and that's when he stopped drinking. So he was the youngest one to stop drinking. And I remember my therapist at the time, if you get this religion of what alcoholism is all about or whatever, you know, you want to tell the world, and I was guilty of that a little bit. And so she said to me, Carol, lecturing doesn't work. Preaching doesn't work. And I said, well, what does work? And she said, your example. And I said to her, but it's so slow. But eventually, the example does work. They begin to gradually see that your life is better in certain ways, or that your life is different in certain ways. And they begin to make their own assumptions rather than my preaching or lecturing. And I'll give you one instance. This same brother, the mascot, Jerry, my youngest daughter was born, and another brother was getting married that weekend, or, you know, about 2 months later. So we brought her to the wedding. And in our family, we didn't celebrate births very much. We didn't celebrate life-changing events all that much. but he had promised me that he would come the Sunday following the wedding to come over and see her. And he didn't come. And I was hurt by it, but I didn't say anything. And he got sober. And about 6 years later, he said to me, you know, one of the reasons I got sober was, do you remember when I was supposed to come over and see Vicki that time? And I couldn't show up because I was so wasted. He said that was one of the moments that I knew that I needed to change my ways. So while it hurt me and it hurt him, who knew that it made a difference? But I didn't find out right then and there. I found out 6 years later. Yes?
You said most of your adult life was spent in therapy.
Just about. I go for tune-ups now. I need a spring tune-up.
What about the other avenues of religion, spirituality, and also Al-Anon? Was any of that in? I started the book, but I haven't got very far yet.
Al-Anon is the greatest 12-step program.
And were you involved in it?
You're not really supposed to acknowledge whether you are. You're supposed to say something like, mental health support group, or I'm not sure what the current buzzword is, but I will tell you, yes, I went to Al-Anon for years. Mm-hmm. I still go occasionally, too. Mm-hmm. And that is where you learn to take the focus off the person that may be using alcohol.
Right. And spirituality or religion?
I have to say I'm not doing too well in that area. And I don't know if it was the tenets of the Catholic Church early in my life that I disagreed with, some sort of disrespect for authority. I do believe, though, that the nuns in the high school where I went, in grammar school, probably gave me the moral structure that I needed, so I'm very supportive of that. Although nuns as a group, probably there isn't that much of it around anymore. But I think Al-Anon is one of the best programs out there. Actually, they have a meeting in Bridgehampton. Southampton, Monday. Yes?
Would you talk a little bit of the Writers' Conference with Frank LaPorte? How did you get into it, and did you bring material to that workshop?
Oh, I recommend the Writers' Conferences very strongly. You need to submit some writing in order to get into the program, but any of you could take one course, and you can do the one course for 9 days or 10 days, whatever it is, and you apply for the particular course you're interested in. So I took many courses at Southampton Writers Conference. So his was one of many that I took, and I was thrilled that he was willing to give me a blurb for the book. But when it was a very special night when I received the Anne Bancroft Award, because the director of the program, Bob Reeves, so I'm sure you know him, he's a great guy, he said to me, so are you coming tonight, Carol? I said, yeah, I'm coming. And that's when they announced that I had received this award. I was sitting there, I was in shock. I wish I could have a little bit more makeup or something. So if you're interested in that, now you could contact them now, and they'll pretty much, it's pretty intense, but they're doing it kind of every other day now. It's a great program.
So you said anyone could go, but you have to be accepted.
You have to be accepted.
By a writing sample.
By a writing sample. You have to submit a writing sample. You can't be saying, oh, I think I'd like to write. You have to have written something to get into the program, and you have to submit it. And it has to be, you know, of some length, I would think 5 pages or something like that. But maybe if it's an essay, it might be 2 or 3. But conditions are that they're happy to help you.
I want to add that at the library, in 1 week from this Saturday, we have a 4-hour personal memoir type workshop. And any of you who might be interested, contact us. You submit your little writing beforehand, and Gabrielle Sells, who's a memoirist, takes a look at it, and then as a little group, you kind of workshop your writing. So if you're interested in that, it's something we offer, and it's happening in a week.
Well, and also I think Frank McCourt's advice, which was to write the hot spots. You're sitting there. You know what was the event in your life, whether you were a child or an adult. at which I view things as before or after. Before mom died, after mom died, before the divorce, after the divorce. So there's a before and after which your life probably changed. And that's maybe what you need to write about. Some people, when they first start out, oh, I'm going to write, and I did this too. There's a part in the book about my not making cheerleading, which I'm still bitter about. But I started reading that at this bookstore in Western Massachusetts, and a friend of mine, who, as it turns out, of course we didn't know it, her father was an alcoholic as well, and she read the book, and she had already lost 3 siblings by the age of 60. When I started reading the cheerleading, she said, Carol, that's not what the book is about. And I'm grateful to her for that, because then I read something comparable to sort of what I put you through today, so, which was about my father, the one and only time my father really ever got angry with me, which was when I poured his whiskey down the drain. Anyone else? Thank you all for coming, and I have books here. Don't take it out of the library. Buy mine. Don't loan it to anyone. It explodes if you loan it. Marianne knows you cannot loan it.